Here we are again, my friends, together in this shared space of worship. I am Susan Boyer, senior pastor of the Laverne Church of the Brethren, and I love who we are together. As flowers bloom, vaccines go into people's arms, and we dream of a time when social distancing is not a phrase we use, I remind us all, me included, to be patient and hold on. Life is changing, and we will walk back into it slowly with the safety of all God's beloved children in our hearts. This week, Pastor Donna is attending her last intensive week of training with StillPoint. Next Sunday, March 21st, she graduates as a certified spiritual director. She's been on this journey for the last couple of years, and she's done it with dedication and joy, and we celebrate with her. And we thank her for her commitment. She has brought so much to us through this training. The Laverne Church of the Brethren gives to the ministries of our denomination through 4 special offerings a year. This month is the first in those opportunities this year, and it is our one great hour of sharing offering. You can give through PayPal right off our website. There's an option for one great hour of sharing there. Or you can mail a check to the church at 2425 East Street, Laverne, California, 91750. Be sure to mark it for one great hour of sharing and make it out to the church. Every year, this congregation has a peacemaker contest called the Benton and Doris Rhodes Peacemaker Award. And it's in the names of 2 former members of this church who were great peacemakers. This is just a reminder to our youth that the deadline for this event is this coming Friday. Finally, please, please, please don't forget to send us a photo or a short video of you or you and your family waving palm branches or streamers or whatever helps you get your Hosanna on, and email it to the church office at office@lavernecob.org by next Sunday, March 21st. Please don't forget. We are creating a video montage of joy for Palm Sunday. And now, my friends, let us wrestle together with the stories of the Bible.
God of the Bible, God in the gospel, hope seen in Jesus, hope yet to come. You are our center, daylight or darkness, freedom or prison, you are our home. Fresh as the morning, sure as the sunrise, God always faithful, you do not change. Fresh as the morning, sure as the sunrise, God always faithful, you do not change.
Struggles, God in our hunger, suffering with us, taking our part. Still you empower us, mothering spirit, feeding, sustaining from your own heart.
Fresh as the shining, as sure as the sunrise, God always faithful, you do not change. Fresh as the faithful, you do not
It's Christy. Thank you for joining me for Children's Storytime today. You know, we've been talking a lot about stories, and Erica Schatz talked about the beginning of a story and how important it is to start your story. Pastor Donna talked about the story of Esther and how courageous she was. Ben Sankey talked about all the wonderful stories that are out there. Today I'm going to be talking about the ending of a story. So to help me with that, I've got a hamburger. So you're wondering, what does a hamburger have to do with a story? Well, the hamburger kind of stands for all the parts that we have that make up a great story. In the beginning, at the top, we have a bun, and that's the beginning of our story. Once upon a time, in a land far away. Next, we have all the ingredients in the hamburger. We have onions, cheese, a hamburger patty, tomatoes, lettuce, and then the bottom of the bun. All these ingredients are like the parts of a story. The events that take place, the characters, what are all the juicy details that happen? And then at the end, the bun stands for the ending. How is the problem solved? What's the moral of the story? It kind of holds it all together. You know, our lives are kind of like a big giant story, a big novel with lots of chapters within it. And sometimes things happen in our lives that we wish we could change, something that's happened in the past, but we really can't change what's happened. What we can do is change what happens in the future. It's kind of like this hamburger. Let's say you made a hamburger and you ate this hamburger and the onions tasted really spicy. So you say to yourself, next time I make that hamburger, I'm going to take out those onions and see how I like it. Just like in life, if there's something that happens, a situation, maybe you have an argument with a friend and you don't like the way it makes you feel. Next time you can do something differently when you're together with that friend. You can be a good listener. You can try to talk out some problems. Come up with a compromise. So, life is kind of like a hamburger. You can always change the things that happen in the future, how you want to make that hamburger in the future. So thanks for joining me today with story time, and I hope you go out and have a great story today.
One of my favorite stories is about the young preacher who went to visit one of the older ladies in the congregation, and while they were visiting in her living room, she got up to answer the phone in the kitchen. While she was out of the room, the pastor noticed a bowl of peanuts on the table beside him. And he thought to himself, maybe I'll just try one. And so he took one, and then he took another, and then a few more. And you know how it is with peanuts. You can't eat just one. And so the longer the lady talked in the kitchen, the more he ate of the peanuts. And so pretty soon, the whole bowl of peanuts was gone. He had eaten them all, every single one. So when the lady finished her conversation and came back into the room, the young pastor confessed. He says, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. He said, I didn't mean to, but I ate all of your peanuts. I'm so sorry. The lady said, oh, pastor, don't worry about it. I can't eat peanuts anymore. All I can do is suck the chocolate off of them. Your offering to the church is the chocolate on the peanut. You have two ways to get your offering to the church. You can use the PayPal button on the website, at lavernecob.org, or you can mail it to the church at 2425 E Street, Laverne, California, 91750. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
I'm Jay Wilkinson, and I'll be reading Genesis chapter 7, verses 11 through 24 from the New Revised Standard Version. In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, on the 17th day of the month, on that day, all fountains of the great deep burst forth, and the windows of the heavens were opened. The rain fell on the ground on the earth 40 days and 40 nights. On the very same day, Noah, with his sons, Shem and Ham and Japheth, and Noah's wife, and the three wives of his sons, entered the ark. They and every wild animal of every kind, and all domestic animals of every kind, and every creeping thing that creeps on the earth, and every bird of every kind, every bird, every winged creature, they went into the ark with Noah, two and two, of all flesh, in which there was breath of life. And those that entered, male and female, of all flesh, went in as God had commanded him, and the Lord shut him in. The flood continued 40 days on the earth, and the waters increased and bore up the ark, and it rose high above the earth. The waters swelled and increased greatly on the earth, and the ark floated on the face of the waters. The waters swelled so mightily on the earth that all the high mountains under the whole heaven were covered. The water swelled above the mountains, covering them 15 cubits deep, and all flesh died that moved on the earth. Birds, domestic animals, wild animals, all swarming creatures that swarm on the earth, and all human beings. Everything on dry land, in whose nostrils was the breath of life, died. He blotted out every living thing that was on the face of the ground. Human beings and animals and creeping things and birds of the air, they were blotted out from the earth. Only Noah was left and those that were with him in the ark. And the waters swelled in the earth for 150 days.
Of all the stories that we live and tell ourselves, there's one with the capacity to open ourselves to the possibilities of new endings and new beginnings, the story of God's love for us. Through prayer, and in particular through body prayer, we work to align the actions of mind, heart, and body in order to enter into this story, thereby opening ourselves for God to live in us and through us. I invite you to join me in prayer. Begin with hands at heart center, a gesture that expresses your intention to be centered in God in this moment. Next, place your hand one in the other like a bowl, and here you offer your whole self to God, just as you are in this moment. Then wrap yourself in a hug. In this posture, receive God's love and compassion. Take it all in. And finally, give it away.
There's no need to hoard this because there is always more where it came from. Again, intention to be centered in the love of God. Offer what you can. Receive God's grace and blessing. Give it all away. I encourage you to move through this prayer as the ensemble sings, "Come and fill our hearts with your peace." And anytime you need a bigger story than the one you're living.
I'm Elizabeth Bay, and I'll be reading Genesis chapter 19, verses 12 through 26. Then the men said to Lot, "Have you anyone else here, sons-in-law, sons, daughters, or anyone you have in the city? Bring them out of the place, for we are about to destroy this place, because the outcry against its people has become great before the Lord. And the Lord has sent us to destroy it." So Lot went out and said to his sons-in-law, who were to marry his daughters, "Up, get out of this place, for the Lord is about to destroy the city." But he seemed to his sons-in-law to be jesting. When morning dawned, the angels urged Lot, saying, "Get up, take your wife and your two daughters who are here, or else you will be consumed in the punishment of the city." But he lingered, so the men seized him and his wife and his two daughters by the hand, the Lord being merciful to him, and they brought him out and left him outside the city. When they had brought them outside, they said, "Flee for your life. Do not look back or stop anywhere in the plain. Flee to the hills, or else you will be consumed." And Lot said to them, "Oh no, my lords, your servant has found favor with you, and you have shown me great kindness in saving my life. But I cannot flee to the hills, for fear the disaster will overtake me and I die. Look, that city is near enough to flee to, and it is a little one. Let me escape there. Is it not a little one? And my life will be saved." He said to him, "Very well. I grant you this favor too, and will not overthrow the city of which you have spoken. Hurry, escape there, for I can do nothing until you arrive there." Therefore the city was called Zoar. The sun had risen on the earth when Lot came to Zoar. Then the Lord rained on Sodom and Gomorrah sulfur and fire from the Lord out of heaven. And he overthrew those cities and all the plain and all the inhabitants of the cities and what grew on the ground. But Lot's wife behind him looked back, and she became a pillar of salt.
I'm not a big fan of a formulaic story. I love to read books or watch movies in which I have no idea where we're going and how it'll end. I like movies like The Sixth Sense, in which the ending surprised me so much, I had to immediately re-watch the movie just to see where the clues were that I missed the first time. But when the movie isn't formulaic, sometimes I feel so sad for the characters in it that I yearn for a formulaic ending. Never happy. I wish Thelma and Louise didn't feel they had to drive off a cliff. I wish John Coffey in The Green Mile would have been understood as a savior instead of strapped to an electric chair and executed for murders he didn't do. I wish the wife in Gone Girl would have gotten her comeuppance. I have the same experience with Bible stories. There are so many Bible stories for which I wish I could change the ending. I chose two of them for today. They both came from the book of Genesis, but don't think I just want to change endings from that book. The first one you heard today is the story of Noah and his life-saving ark. Well, life-saving for a few. Well, a very select few. The story of Noah is actually a horrible tale. God doesn't look very good in this story. So what do we do with it? We take images from this horrendous tale and we decorate our children's nurseries with it. I did. Come on, it has a big boat with giraffes and rhinos and elephants and tigers and cockatoos on it. Such an intriguing image. But it becomes problematic when our children begin wanting to hear the story about why there's a boat floating in the sea with a menagerie of animals on it and a gorgeous rainbow that curves right over the top of the ark. They think this has to be a beautiful story. None of us wants to say, well, once upon a time, God was like an angry alcoholic parent. God was sick and tired of people not doing what he wanted. So God decided to wipe out all the humans and the animals. But there was this one guy who was really righteous and good, and his name was Noah. So God had Noah build a really big boat. Noah was supposed to take his family and at least two of every kind of animal onto this big boat. And then God caused it to rain and rain and rain until all humans and all animals were gone except for those on the boat. When Noah and his family and all the animals on the ark finally were able to find dry land and get off the boat, God realized that punitive, righteous anger was not the best way to relate to creation. So to make up, God sent a rainbow and said, "I'm sorry I acted like that. I promise it'll never happen again." I didn't want to tell my children that story. Somehow Noah and his family are supposed to be overjoyed by God's promise. It just feels like too little compared to the enormity of death and destruction they witnessed. I want to change this ending. It just doesn't preach. When I crawl around inside this story, I have to witness Noah collecting the animals and realizing that the ones he doesn't choose are going to die. I have to watch Noah pull up the gangplank when the rain starts. Breaks my heart. He knows what's going to happen to his neighbors and friends. These are the people he worshiped alongside. The ones at the other end of the gangplank, those are his extended family, his in-laws, his best friends since grammar school. How traumatizing. And then when the rain finally stops and the land finally dries up enough to get off the boat that was at once their salvation and their hell, they have to create everything anew, surrounded by mud. They're filled with survivor's guilt and so many questions about who God is. If I could write new endings to Bible stories, I would start with this one. And once I was able to sanitize the story of Noah and the ark, tie it up in a neat little bow with a loving God, then I'd move on and tackle the story of Lot's wife. Once again, in this story, God is angry enough to destroy humanity, but this time focuses in on two cities, Sodom and Gomorrah. Abraham steps in and talks God into saving his relative Lot and Lot's family. Abraham makes the case that Lot is a righteous man. I'm kind of surprised by that, because there are several stories about Lot that I find problematic. God tells Abraham he'll save Lot and his family, and God sends two angels to help the family get out of town before it goes up in smoke. As the family is fleeing, one of the angels says, "Run for your lives and don't look back, lest you be consumed." Sounds like a common sense warning to me, not a threat. Like, say you're running from a burning building and the firefighter says, "Keep moving, don't turn around, get out of here as fast as you can." Sounds like sage advice. Lot's wife turned back. She'd grown up in Sodom. Her in-laws were back there, as well as her parents and her beloved aunt. She can't believe she's being rushed away from all she's ever known. So she looks back to see what's happening to those she has loved her whole life. And the Bible tells us she was turned into a pillar of salt. Why? For the horrible sin of looking backwards? And salt? Why salt? I hate that ending. Luckily, it isn't considered beautiful and whimsical enough to adorn our children's nursery rooms with it. At least there's that. Do you have Bible stories for which you want to write different endings? I'm guessing that most of us do. We have a deep need, a profound desire to take these stories and sanitize them so that they fit into our narrative of who God is and how the people of God are supposed to behave. I fully agree with that need. That's where I'm at. But I know that there are some who just opt to leave out the parts they don't like. And there are some who just ignore the whole Bible altogether. After all, it just feels so archaic and problematic. Why even bother with it at all? I want to make a case for why none of these three options is a good answer to the challenge of difficult Bible stories. This book is unique to our modern way of thinking. It does not have one author. In fact, most of the books in the Bible don't just have one author. This is especially true of the Hebrew Bible. These are stories and songs and poetry that were told orally, adapted, retold, adapted, told again and again and again and again, and handed down from one generation to another until they were finally written down. The story of Noah and the story of Lot's wife were formed and touched and shaped and molded by community. They are collective stories with many, many voices in them. The New Testament does not have the same long oral history as the books of the Hebrew Bible, but the stories in the four Gospels were not written down after they happened. I remember sitting in a church sanctuary that had stained glass windows of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Each one depicted a man sitting at a desk with quill poised in hand, looking upward. These windows conveyed the idea that the Gospels were dictated by a heavenly voice, and these four men simply acted as scribes. But the Gospels tell well-worn tales of Jesus' life. The feeding of the multitude is found six times in the four Gospels. The Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John have written down oral tradition about Jesus, and each one puts a different theological spin on the stories they tell. The Bible is a book of weighty complexities. In it we find texts of terror, unknowable mysteries, beautiful poetry, deep longings, tragic endings, hopeful beginnings, the ugliness of human nature, the gift of sacrificial love, prejudice, calls for justice, awe, bravery, music, love stories, narcissism, suffering, hope, promise, resurrection, just to name a few. The Bible's the grand story of God and God's relationship with us. This is not a book about morality. If you're looking for a list of rights and wrongs, just read Leviticus and be done with it. But you won't like what you read. The Bible is story. And like Jacob, it requires that we step into the story and wrestle with God as we read it. Actually, when these stories got written down and then brought together into this sacred book that we call the Bible, the beauty, adaptation, and fluidity of these stories got frozen in time. And we Christians have forgotten how to interact with these stories, how to let them live. These grand stories of God require us to be in relationship to them, just as God wants to be in relationship with us. So I don't think we need to write new endings to these old stories or leave out the stories that are problematic or just ignore the Bible altogether. Instead, we need to hear these stories. And then we need to ask ourselves, why did the people of Israel choose to tell this story and tell it this way? Was there a flood and they needed to make sense of it? Were Sodom and Gomorrah destroyed and they had to put it into some kind of context? Did they need to encourage people to move from mourning the past to living into the future? What do these stories have to say to me and to you about God? What do they have to say about our relationship with God as we live these problematic and beautiful and complex lives with which we have been blessed? What stories do we need to tell about our own lives? If this book were just stories in which everything gets tied up beautifully in the end by a God who steps in and intervenes with love and justice, we wouldn't be able to relate to them because we don't have lives in which everything gets tied up in a neat bow, in which the wife and gone girl gets her comeuppance, in which the Christ-like John Coffey in the Green Mile is freed and a parade thrown in his honor, in which Thelma and Louise drive off into the sunset, alive and free. I want us to wander through the stories of the Bible in hopes, in search of a wisdom born of centuries of telling and retelling that help us form our own stories. We won't always find it right away, but I promise we will always brush up against something bigger than our own lives and our own experiences. Sometimes these stories will give us peace, and sometimes we will end up in a wrestling match with God. And like Jacob, we'll walk away with a blessing and a limp. But let us trust each other and God enough to wander together through the Bible's pages, searching for new truths, new calls to action, and a deeper relationship with the God she describes in her pages. And as we are on that journey together, I believe that it'll bring us to new awareness of how we might create our own stories together. I pray that our struggle leads us to the kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.
Of God, born of
hear the story of God. Brush up against the contours of her shape, feel the rhythm of her heartbeat. Listen for the call within her pages as we seek together to become part of the kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.